Hello and welcome to this modern line of business app deployment session for the Microsoft Virtual Academy. My name is Simon May and I'm an infrastructure evangelist here within Microsoft. One of the things I look at is how we go about making sure that people's applications can be deployed out to many different sizes of enterprise. This set of videos that comprises the course will actually take you through the deployment of line of business applications using various different methods. For a start, we'll take a look at PowerShell. We'll also have a look at using System Center Configuration Manager, so 2012 Service Pack 1, in order to be able to do some deployment. We'll also use Windows Intune, and we'll use the two in combination with one another. We'll also look at deploying onto various different platforms, those being Windows 8 and Windows RT. So without further ado, let's have a look at the modern app deployment fundamentals. In this section, we're going to kind of work out the nomenclature that's changed around deployment for Windows 8 applications and for Windows RT applications, and kind of work through the common language that you'll need to understand in order to be able to really get to grips with all the content in the rest of the modules. So the objectives across this particular module are so that you can understand the terms, but also understand the different types of deployment that we'll be using, and specifically how you can go about deploying those using the various different deployment methods that we have in place. There are obviously some requirements that we need to have in place in order to be able to make sure those deployments do work through completely. And as everybody knows that has anything to do with deployment, it's not a one-time activity. There is a life cycle that you'll need to be able to manage as well. That's things like uninstalling and removing software down the line. So let's take a look at some of those terms. You may not have come across these kind of terms before. The first one is sideloading, and the sideloading process is kind of what we use for most line of business applications. It's the process of taking the APEX package files, which are the group of assets that are used inside of the application, combined into an APEX package, and being able to take that package and land it on a device and have it install and be available for the end user. The next option is deep linking, and this differs from sideloading. Whereas with sideloading, we have the APEX package. With the deep linking process, we don't actually have access to those APEX files. Instead, they're stored in the Microsoft Windows Store. You never, as a line of business application, have access to the APEX files. It is possible, however, that you'll find that there are applications within the Windows Store that you want to make available to your end users. It could be that a application vendor has created something which is a line of business application and there is some kind of special licensing mode available for that application. The deep linking process actually allows us to take something like our enterprise app store or our enterprise application catalog and actually push a link into that catalog which takes the user directly to the Windows Store and then allows them to be able to complete the installation themselves. There are some requirements that are in place for sideloading an application. The first one is kind of obvious. You have to have access to the installation files, the APEX package files for the application. Secondly, is the fact that the APEX file has to actually be signed by a trusted code signing certificate. And by that, we mean that the code signing certificate has to be trusted by the device to which you are deploying the APEX package file. We'll have a look at these requirements in a little bit more detail in a few moments, but just try and absorb them for the moment. Sideloading is also needs to be enabled on the target device. And by enabled on the target device, that actually is just a registry setting that needs to be set, and it's possible to do this through group policy, as you would expect to in any large enterprise environment. Finally, there's a licensing requirement. The device has to be licensed for sideloading. That's either going to be the case that you'll need to install a sideloading product key, or you might have a device such as a Windows 8 Enterprise device where sideloading is already licensed. So let's have a look at these in more detail. When I say you have to have access to the APEX package file, that means that you'll be given the APEX package by the developer of the application. Now, if that's an in-house development team, that should be a really simple process of just asking them for the files. However, it could be a third party that's created the application for you. Again, it should be a case of just asking them for the right set of files. They will also potentially give you a set of dependencies, particularly if the application has been written with HTML and JavaScript. You'll find that there's an extra set of dependency files that are required. When the application developer creates these files using Visual Studio, there is an automatic set of files that are output as part of the build process. you don't actually need all of these files. Those files include certificate files, which are actually a self-signed certificate created for the application developer by Visual Studio to enable them to locally test the app. There's also a PowerShell file, which is actually, if you look at it, quite interesting, a very complicated PowerShell script, which allows for the installation of that app onto a device which has been licensed as a developer device. You don't need to use that either. We can do this completely without using those files. That Apex package also has to be signed with a trusted code signing certificate. As I said earlier, that has to be trusted by the target device. Normally, that'll be something like your enterprise root CA, and if you're in a domain-joined environment, all of the devices that are joined to the domain will automatically trust your enterprise root CA. So, taking a certificate that is created by that CA will be trusted by those devices. However, you might actually not be in a domain-joined environment. There are some ways to work around this. You may also not be able to provide the developer with access to a certificate from your enterprise root CA. So they may have to go off and buy a certificate from a trusted root certification authority. Again, this is completely valid. If, for example, you do have devices which aren't domain joined, such as could be the case with the Microsoft Windows RT device, then we have mechanisms within, say, Windows Intune to actually be able to deploy the correct certificate to the device to enable it to be trusted. The third requirement is that sideloading is enabled on the target device. This is quite a simple thing to do. On the device itself, if it's been domain joined, you can actually go and find the group policy setting, which I've listed on this particular slide that you're seeing on screen here. And once that's been enabled, all devices that are subject to that policy will be able to install any sideloaded applications, assuming that they're licensed to do so. If the device isn't domain joined, there's a couple of ways that you can actually enable this setting. The first is that you can use the local group policy module to actually be able to go and make that settings change, or you could manually change the registry setting if for some reason you're not deploying things using group policy. Finally, there's the requirement for the device to be licensed for sideloading. If you have a Windows 8 Enterprise device and it's domain joined, then sideloading is enabled by default. You don't need any kind of product key. If you have a Windows 8 Enterprise device that is not domain joined, then you'll need to provide a sideloading product key. If you have a Windows 8 Pro device, you'll always need to provide a sideloading product key. And if you have a Windows RT device that is never possible to be domain joined, again, you'll need to provide a sideloading product key. These product keys can be obtained from the Microsoft volume licensing portal, and you can buy them in packs of 1,000 sideloading keys. Once you've got hold of one of those sideloading keys, you need to actually add it and activate it on the device. In order to do that, we use the SLMGR VBS script with the IPK switch, and we also provide the product key that you need that you've got from your volume licensing portal. Then we need to go and activate that particular key. Now, this is a very interesting kind of command line here. The GUID that's part of this command line always has to be this exact GUID. It's not the product key that you entered in the previous step. This whole thing can be scripted. It may seem like it's a slightly painful process to run these two lines of code on the device, but you can actually script them. So if you have, say, a Windows 8 Pro device that you're enrolling into Windows Intune, you might create a script to actually enable the sideloading product key on all devices that are actually enrolled within your Windows Intune service. When we sideload a device with an app, we have to make a decision over whether it's the actual user that we want to make the app available for, or whether we're going to be making the app available for all users on that device. The difference here is that a sideloaded app is installed just for one user. A provisioned app is installed for all of the users on that particular machine. What happens in that case is that we put the provisioned app into the image, and then when users log on to that device for the first time, after that app has been installed, they will actually automatically have the app installed for them. That means that it is possible to have a deployment where everything starts to happen automatically, but in many cases it's actually easier to sideload the apps on an individual by individual basis. And that's exactly what we do with a tool like Configuration Manager or Windows Intune. If, however, we were creating our original gold image for deployment, we would probably be looking at using a provisioned app. Provisioned apps do have some requirements as well, and some restrictions. The first is that we can only have 24 provisioned apps on any one device. And that actually includes the built-in apps that come as part of Windows 8 or Windows RT. So in this case, actually, we only end up with about 10 slots that are available by default for being able to add additional provisioned apps. Every time anybody logs onto that machine, as I said, the app isn't going to be installed for that user the next time that they complete their logon. And one of the things that people do find a little bit strange about this is they sometimes expect the app to kind of magically synchronize itself across all the different devices that the end user is actually logging into. Of course, that's not the case. They have to actually have been provisioned or sideloaded onto every single device the user wants to be able to use that app on. And finally, you can go through the process of provisioning apps into an image before you've enabled sideloading or installed a sideloading product key onto that device. That means that if you were building your gold image, you could pop the apps in there that you wanted to, and then you can allow the group policy settings that are applied to your domain to actually enable sideloading as that device comes out of sysprep a little bit later down the line. There's a couple of ways that we can go through the process of sideloading applications onto any one of our devices. The next module in this series is going to talk about sideloading with PowerShell. And we're going to go through the PowerShell commands that are used just particularly to do sideloading on a device. That's actually a really useful module to gain a good understanding of everything that goes on around the mechanics of sideloading onto a Windows 8 device. The next route is to take something like System Center Configuration Manager 2012 SP1. It needs to be the SP1 version in order to be able to do sideloading for Windows 8. Modules 3, 4, 9, 10, and 11 are going to look at using System Center Configuration Manager in some way in order to be able to do those deployments to Windows 8 and Windows RT devices. Windows Intune is the other tool that's available for doing sideloading deployments of line of business apps onto Windows 8 and Windows RT devices. There we're going to have a look at using Windows Intune across modules 5, 6, 9, 10, and 11. And you'll notice there that there's quite a little bit of overlap there. Modules 9, 10, and 11 are going to talk about both using Configuration Manager and Windows Intune. The reason that we're going to do that in those three modules is that in module 9, we will take our System Center Configuration Manager environment and link it to a Windows Intune tenant. By doing that, we get the ability to support devices which are maybe Windows RT devices, or in fact are not joined into our domain. They could be bring your own devices. Any kind of different permutation on those two. Just to go back and have a quick look at and think about the deep linking process for a moment. Any apps that we find inside of the Windows Store, you can deep link to in your company app store or your company app portal. There's no restriction there over whether they're paid apps or free apps or trial apps. What you can do is just pick any of those apps. In many cases, you need to have the application installed, but in some cases, you don't. Windows Intune is a prime example of where you don't have to have pre-installed an application in order to be able to do the deployment. Configuration Manager actually does need you to have installed the application onto one device in order to be able to complete the deployment. In that case, if it was a very expensive paid application, maybe you could use a trial of the application in order to complete the deployment. One of the interesting things about a deep linked application, and this kind of feels a little bit alien to deployment specialists when they come across this for the first time, is that you can't force an application to be installed for an end user. You can actually, within Configuration Manager, set an application to be required, but it won't complete the installation in a completely unattended way. The user actually has to go and do some things. They have to go into the Windows Store and click the Install button or the Buy button for the application. And the reason for that is that there's a little kind of user consent piece there, and the user is actually responsible for paying for that application themselves. In order to use sideloading, there needs to be a Microsoft account registered on the device, either within the Windows Store app or registered to the device itself and against the user's account. The place where deep linking works the best inside of an enterprise is actually for kind of curating the Windows Store. It helps you to go along, select the applications that are maybe the most pertinent or the best for your users. So you may decide that you want to suggest a particular news app to go and use. You may find that your organization is a prime user of Microsoft Dynamics, and there's a Microsoft Dynamics app inside of the store, and you'd like to recommend that to your end users. It's incredibly good at making that recommendation engine, allowing you to kind of curate and cut down the amount of information that's inside the Windows Store. Outside of installing apps, which we've looked at so far, there's also the ability to remove apps. And you notice that I don't really use the word uninstall here. In fact, we never really see uninstall referred to as part of Windows 8 applications, apart from within Configuration Manager. Apps can always be removed with PowerShell, and they can be uninstalled only by the current user. If we take away one app for one user, that doesn't remove the app files for every user on that machine. If we think about maybe a traditional application that was deployed using an MSI file, if we uninstalled the app, nobody else on the machine will be able to use that app. However, in the case of modern apps, that's not actually a problem. The apps are available for each user in each particular time. We can also remove any apps which we've provisioned in advance. So we could take them out of the image, and that actually includes the apps that come with Windows. So if we decided that the music or the video app weren't something we wanted as part of our image, we could remove them. When we do that removal of an app, they don't actually get removed for all users at that time. We actually stop the addition of that app when it's been provisioned for new users. And anybody who already has the application will also have to go and uninstall their own copy of that app. The next part of the application lifecycle is around updating apps. Once we've deployed our apps, there's going to be updates. In the case of sideloading, it's your responsibility as the administrator of that line of business app to go and deploy the updates for the app. One of the things that's been built into this app model, which works really well, is the fact that if you deploy an app that has a higher version number than the app which is already on a device, it will be updated. If the version number of the update that you're deploying is lower than the version that's installed on a machine, then the update won't actually take place. It won't win. So you have to be sure that the internal version number within the app is always higher. Any apps which have been deployed by a deep link will be updated automatically from the Windows Store. And in fact, in the case of Windows 8, the user will have to go into the Windows Store and apply those particular updates. That brings us to the end of this section on the nomenclature for deploying Windows 8 apps, modern apps, line of business apps. In the next section, we're going to go and have a look at use of PowerShell in order to be able to do those deployments. However, here and now are some extra resources that you might find useful around the requirements for sideloading on Windows 8 devices.